Okay, just starting. All right, I guess it's 7:01 and then the live stream has started, so I'll get started. Welcome everybody. This is going to be an invited talk by Phokion, Kolaitis on structural characterizations of rule-based languages. Phokion, Kolaitis, he's a distinguished research professor that we're honored to be, have here from UC Santa Cruz, and he's also a research staff member at IBM Almaden. And his work is mainly on principles on database systems, logic in computer science, and computational complexity, as illustrated by various publications at mostly at venues like Pods and Leaks, as everybody knows. And he has had seminal work that has been recognized multiple times. His work on data exchange has won the ICDT Test of Time Award, and just last year, the Church Award at Siglog. And his work on conjunctive queries and the complexity and various results related to that was Test of Time Award for 2008 Pods. And his work on second order tuple generating dependencies, which he will, I'm assuming, will touch on in this talk, won the Test of Time Award at 2014 Pods. And in particular for me, it's important to recognize Phokion Kolaitis' work, because when I was a PhD student and started working on Datalog, his work with Moshe Vardy on various results on computation complexity of Datalog and various flavors of it, gave me a lot of fundamental knowledge and ideas on what can be done further. So it's an honor for me to introduce Phokion Kolaitis, and go ahead.
Thank you very much for this kind and generous introduction. I'm delighted to be here. I want to thank the organizers. It's a true honor, especially because I'm not a mainstream person of the logic programming community. All my professional life has been dedicated to logic and computer science, but not within logic programming. So it's a particular honor to be here. Since the topic may not be familiar to many of you, I want to start by trying to describe the topic in a slightly bigger setting, put it in the right perspective, in other words. So I want to start by asking the question, what logic is all about? And I think we will all agree that logic is concerned with the interplay between syntax and semantics. And when a student takes a logic course, typically the student learns how to go from syntax to semantics. So for instance, a typical question is, you are given a set of sentences in some logic L, what properties do the models of sigma possess? But this is a two-way interaction, it's a two-way street. There is another direction of research that goes from semantics to syntax. In this setting, one starts typically with a class of structures, and then a typical question, not the only question, but the typical question is, what structural properties of the class guarantee that the class is definable in the logic? So we are going to focus on the second area of research, going from semantics to syntax. But before I go on and give you some examples of this to illustrate what I have in mind, let me set the discussion by introducing some terminology and notation. Throughout this talk, we're going to be working with a relational schema, or simply a schema. So that's a tuple of relation symbols, each of which comes with a specified arity, a number of arguments. And then a relational structure is simply a tuple consisting of a non-empty set, which is called the universe of the structure, and relations on the universe, each of which matches the arity of the corresponding relation symbol. So this is standard terminology. And I will also need the notion of a substructure. So a structure B is a substructure of a structure A. If the universe of B is a subset of the universe of A, and the relations on B are the restrictions of the relations on the universe of B. So this is a generalization of the notion of an induced subgraph in graph theory. And I'm going to write B contained in A to denote that B is a substructure of it. So with this notation and terminology, I want to go back and look at some results in the direction going from syntax to semantics. And perhaps the first result that one learns, or one of the first results that one learns in a database course, is suppose that you have a universal first order sentence. And universal first order sentence means in prenext normal form, it only has universal quantifiers. Then psi is preserved under substructures, which means if the structure A satisfies the sentence and you have a substructure of A, then the substructure also satisfies the sentence. This is an elementary exercise, follows directly from the semantics and the syntax. A deeper theorem that we are all familiar with is the compactness theorem. It says you have a set of first order sentences and every finite subset of sigma has a model, then sigma has a model. This is a very powerful theorem. But again, it's in the same spirit. You start with the syntax and you prove something about the models of the sentences. A companion to the compactness theorem is the Levenheim's column theorem, which actually preceded the compactness theorem. This was proved around 1917, 1920. And this says that if you have a set of first order sentences, finite or infinite, if sigma has an infinite model, then it must have a model which is countable, meaning finite or countably infinite. So this is a powerful result because, for instance, an immediate consequence is that there is no set of first order sentences, finite or infinite, that characterizes the real numbers up to isomorphism because the real numbers are uncountable. So these are the results, typical results going from syntax to semantics. Now let's go back to the first proposition, the preservation under substructures, and let's try to look at it from the other side, going from semantics to syntax. Now we have a beautiful theorem. It's referred to as the Wostarski theorem, proved around 1948, and says if you have a first order sentence, and this sentence happens to be preserved under substructures, then the sentence is logically equivalent to a universal first order sentence. So here we have a perfect match of syntax and semantics. The first order sentences that are preserved under substructures are up to logical equivalence precisely the universal ones. And this is going from semantics to syntax. That was 1948. 21 years later, in a rather unexpected development took place. And this development is called Lindstrom's theorem, named after the Swedish logician and philosopher Per Lindstrom, who proved that first order logic is a maximal logic, is the strongest logic that satisfies some mild closure properties, such as being closed under conjunctions and disjunctions, and possesses both the compactness theorem and the Levenheim's column theorem. As I said, this came out of the blue. It's a beautiful theorem because it tells you that in some sense, the compactness theorem and the Levenheim's column theorem characterize first order logic. So these are results going from semantics to syntax. And why should we care about these results? Well, first of all, in my view, at least, these are beautiful results. If we had a way to assign aesthetic measure to theorems, I think the value of this aesthetic measure for these theorems would be very high. But let's look what they do for us. In some sense, the first one tells us that the syntactic notion of being a universal sentence exhausts the semantic notion of being logically equivalent, being preserved under substructures. Lindstrom's theorem characterizes first order logic with just these two theorems, compactness and Levenheim's column. It tells you it's the strongest logic. If you have another logic that has these properties, this satisfies the theorems, it has to be a sublanguage of first order logic. So you can think of these results as providing an alternative way to think about the expressive power of logics. Instead of looking at what queries they can express or what is the computational complexity of a certain log, the model checking problem of a logic, here these results tell us something about the expressive power in terms of the model theoretic properties. So I rest my case as to why I believe that these results are important. And now I want to focus on, start focusing on what happened after that. and slowly get to the topic of the course, the topic of the lecture. So Lindstrom's theorem, late 60s, became the catalyst for numerous subsequent investigations. The 70s were a very active period of research in which logicians tried to characterize structurally logic stronger than first-order logic. They knew by Lindstrom they have to give up either on Skolem-Levenheim or on compactness, or on both. And this work was codified in a nice handbook on model theoretic logics by Barwise and Pfefferman. By the way, from now on, if you see two names, there is a link to the paper or book, so you can follow the references. Whenever you see names, there is a link to the corresponding piece of work. So this happened by mathematical logicians, but if independently of this, there was a lot of work on structural characterizations of fragments of first-order logic. So while logicians went above first-order logic, computer scientists started looking at fragments of first-order logic, and this was done by researchers in database theory, logic in CS more broadly, AI, and description logics, and so on. So what I want to tell you today, I want to talk about structural characterizations of rule-based languages. And this, of course, there are many rule-based languages. As Tanke already alluded, I will be focusing on tuple-generating dependencies. This was also in the abstract. And these are also known as existential rules or Datalog plus minus. Datalog plus minus was mentioned repeatedly in the panel a couple of days ago that we had on Datalog, and I'll say a few words about it as we go on. Where did these tuple generating dependencies came from? Where did they come from? They came really in the study of database theory. And they go by the name database dependencies, whereby database dependencies are integrity constraints that the data of interest ought to obey. You can think of this as being semantic restrictions that the legal data must obey. These were introduced, the first type of dependencies was introduced by Ted Codd, the founder of the relational data model. And then there was an explosion of research, and a whole bunch of different dependencies were studied in the 70s. Inclusion dependencies, multi-value dependencies, joint dependencies, it looked like a zoo. It was very hard to parse out the landscape. And then it was realized through the work of Phokion and independently by Biri and Vardy that all these various classes I mentioned before and many others were special cases of a single family, the tuple-generating dependencies. And you can see the history of the subject and all these definitions in a nice survey by Phokion and Vardy. Again, there are links to the survey. Let me motivate the definition of tuple-generating dependencies by looking at inclusion dependencies. So suppose we have a database about universities in which we have two relations, among others, a relation in role whose columns have the student ID, the student name, and the course, and another relation called grade, where now we have the student ID, the course, and the grade. And of course, an integrity constraint is that by the end of the quarter, every student enrolled in a course is assigned a grade. And the registrar office in my university sends me nasty reminders if I have not submitted the grade for a student. I'm sure this happens to all of you. This is an example of an inclusion dependency, and in database jargon is denoted by this. This means that if you project the enroll relation on student ID and course, you get a sub-relation of the projection of the relation grade on student ID and course. For our purposes, the important thing is that this inclusion dependency is expressible in first-order logic. And it's expressible by this first-order sentence, which says that for every tuple made up of a student, a name, and a course, if S and C belongs to enroll, then there is a value G standing for grade so that the tuple SCG belongs to grade. So the point here is that this first order sentence expresses, formalizes the integrity constraint. Every student enrolled in a course is assigned a grade. Let's take a closer look at this first order sentence. What is the structure of the sentence? It has a bunch of universal quantifiers. And then we have an implication. On the left-hand side of the implication, we have here an atom. And on the right side of the implication, we have an atom and an existential quantification in front of an atom. Now take this syntax and allow yourself to have more than one atoms on the left and more than one atoms on the right. And voila, you've arrived at tuple-generating dependencies. So the definition of a tuple-generating dependency, or TGD, and I will use the two interchangeably since tuple-generating dependency is a mouthful, the definition is that a TGD is a first-order sentence of the form, for all x, phi of x implies exist y, psi, x prime, and y, where phi and psi are conjunctions of atoms. Maybe just one atom, but in general, they're conjunctions of atoms. And there is a safety condition that the variables in x prime are among those in x. So you export some, you are allowed to export all if you want, but you export some of the variables or none in the right-hand side. Here is an example, which is a variation of the example we saw before. I'm assuming now we have in the database four relations, student with a student ID and the name, takes student ID course, teaches instructor course, and grade student course grade. And then you can have the integrity constraint that says for every triple student ID, name, and course, if the student ID and the name belongs to student, and the student ID and course belongs to takes, then there is an instructor and a grade, and the instructor teaches the course, and the student gets this grade in that course. So this is the syntax of tuple-generating dependencies. What is the intuition about behind them? They assert, basically, that the existence of a certain pattern, the pattern being phi of x, implies the existence of another pattern together with some additional elements, and that's the exist y, psi, x prime y. More formally, if you come from databases, you can think every tuple-generating dependency as being an assertion that a certain conjunctive query, and the conjunctive query is a conjunction of atoms, perhaps with some existential quantifiers in the front, a conjunction of atoms in the left-hand side is contained in some other conjunctive query. So these TGDs express the containment of one conjunctive query into another conjunctive query. It is interesting to note that if you take any book on mathematical logic written by a mathematical logician, you will never see the definition of tuple-generating dependencies. This is a class that was really invented in the context of database theory. It's one of the impacts of logic, of computer science in logic. And they are quite important in database theory, and as we will see in other areas. Tuple-generating dependencies contain special other classes of dependencies. First of all, and closer to this community, a full TGD is a TGD with no existential quantifiers in the right-hand side. So it is of the form phi of x implies psi x prime, where phi and psi are conjunctions of atoms. A very special case of a full TGD is where the right-hand side has a single atom. Well, that's a Horn formula, so it is a Datalog rule. And in fact, full TGDs and Datalog rules are in some sense the same. The sense they are the same is that every full TGD is logically equivalent to a finite set of Datalog rules because we can decompose, we can break up. If I have this full TGD that says PXYZ implies QXY and TYZ, this is logically equivalent to the set consisting of these two Datalog rules. This decomposition cannot take place in general if I get the existential quantifiers, because the existential quantifiers may bind the different atoms. So we see already that the TGDs contain full TGDs and in particular Datalog rules as a special case. Years later, after the work in database theory took place, motivated from work in knowledge representation and other related topics, the family of guarded TGDs came into being. And this has many members. I have picked up here three prominent such members. First of all, a linear TGD is a TGD whose left-hand side has a single atom. A guarded TGD is a TGD in which, in the left-hand side, in the antecedent of the implication, there is an atom that contains all the universally quantified variables. So this atom is the guard that protects the universally quantified variables. These are called guarded TGDs, and they are part of a fragment of first-order logic called the guarded fragment, which has been studied extensively by different communities in the last 20 years. There is a more relaxed notion of guardedness, and this goes by the name frontier guarded. So a TGD is a frontier guarded TGD if in the left-hand side you have an atom that contains all the variables that are exported in the right-hand side. The guard doesn't guard all the universally quantified variables. It only guards the ones that are exported to the right. When you see these definitions, you realize that there is an obvious containment. The inclusion dependencies we saw in the very beginning are contained in the linear TGDs. They are contained in the guarded, and the guarded are contained in the frontier guarded. The example in the middle for all x, y, z, r1 x, y, and r2 y, z implies r3 x, y, is an example of a frontier guarded because the variables exported are x and y. And here on the left-hand side, we have the guard r1. So this is frontier guarded, but not guarded because the left-hand side contains also z, and there is no atom that contains all three x, y, and z. And it's important to note that there are very useful and basic dependencies that are not frontier guarded. For example, this last one, which expresses the transitivity of the relation R, is clearly not frontier guarded, because the frontier consists of X and Z, and we don't have on the left-hand side an atom that contains X and Z. So this is one family of TGDs that has been studied in depth. And then there is another family that has come up in the study of data exchange. And yes, I will say something about data exchange at the end. Here we have TGDs in which the relations that occur on the left are disjoint from the relations that occur on the right. So we can formalize this by saying that we have two schemas with no relation symbols in common, and a source to target TGD or STTGD is a TGD in which all the atoms in the left-hand side come from S and all the atoms in the right-hand side come from T. In the data integration community, these are also known as global and local as view constraints. I don't want to explain the terminology. It has to do with the concepts in data integration. And there are all sorts of restrictions of those. For instance, if you take source to target and impose linearity, meaning one atom on the left, you get the linear STTGDs, which are also known in data integration as lab constraints, local as view constraints. So what have I done so far? I have introduced source to target TGDs, and I have also shown you various families of source to target TGDs, to which I will come and describe results about them later on. What are the uses of TGDs? I already argued that originally were introduced in order to express integrity constraints in databases. I don't need to tell you that full TGDs are the building blocks of Datalog programs, right? And so in some sense, they form the syntax of Datalog. But in the last 15 years or so, 20 years, they have been used in knowledge representation. And more recently, in an area called ontology-mediated query answering, because the Tgds there describe the axioms of the ontology. I will refer you to the survey of Datalog plus minus by Kali, Godlob, Lukasiewicz, and Pieris, and the survey on ontology-mediated query answering by Bienveni and Ortiz. The term Datalog plus minus, as already Moshe Vardy said on Wednesday, was coined by Godlob to indicate that with Tgds you go beyond Datalog because you allow existential quantification in the right-hand side. But then to ensure good algorithmic behavior, you take back something from the left-hand side. That's why you get into the guarded family, the guarded, the frontier guarded, and the like. As for the source to target Tgds, they form the main specification language in both data exchange and data integration. I refer you to the monograph on data exchange by Arenas and others, and the survey of data on data integration by Lenzerini from a POTS conference some years back. So this is the background, the notions that I need. And now I want to address the question, let's take this lens of going from syntax to semantics and from semantics to syntax and apply to tuple generating dependencies. So suppose I have a finite set of Tgds. What structural properties do the models possess? This is a question in the first direction going from syntax to semantics. In the other direction going from semantics to syntax, suppose I have a class of structures. What structural properties of the class guarantee that the class is definable by a finite set of Tgds? And this means, is there a finite set of Tgds such that for every structure A, A belongs to the class if and only if A satisfies this finite set of Tgds? This is a subject, the second one, that has been looked at for quite some time. And very early, Makovsky and Vardy had a very nice paper back in 1986 that gave structural characterizations of full Tgds and other class of constraints, but including full Tgds. Then 10 years ago or so, Balder Tenkade and myself, motivated from what was going on in data exchange, we obtained structural characterizations of social target Tgds, and I will mention them in the last part of the talk. But this work left out, are there structural characterizations of arbitrary finite sets of Tgds? So there is a new result that I want now to discuss. It's a result by Marco Console at Rome, Andreas Pieris at Endibor, and myself. It was presented in the POTS conference in June. And we basically characterize what it takes for a class of structures to be definable by a finite set of Tgds. And the theorem says that the class of structures is definable by a finite set of Tgds if and only if C has the following three structural properties. It is critical, it is closed under direct products, and it is local. And of course, I will define these notions so that we can make sense out of what the theorem says. But notice that this is an if and only if statement. The direction one implies two is going from syntax to semantics. The direction two implies one, which is the main topic of this talk, is going from semantics to syntax, okay? They say that in the wedding, you have to have something old, the bride has to have something old and something new, and this is the case here. The notions of critical and closed under direct products are not new. In fact, they were already considered by Makovsky and Vard. The notion of locality that we use, though, is new. And I will spend some time trying to motivate this. It's quite a technical notion, but turned out to be the right notion to prove this theorem. Now, when I say the notion of locality is new, I mean the notion of locality that I will introduce next. Other notions of locality have been studied for 40 years now in mathematical logic and database theory. In fact, it was interesting. Yesterday, Stuart Russell mentioned the seminal work of Chaim Geifman on probability measures and first-order logic. The same Chaim Geifman in 1982 introduced a notion of locality for first order logic, which turned out to be very useful in finite model theory. This is a different notion of locality. I'm trying to make the point here that we have understood for some time that locality is important in the study of first order logic, but this notion of locality is tailored to Tgds, as we will see. Okay, so now let me proceed and explain these notions of criticality, closure under direct products, and finally locality. The first one is very straightforward. We need to define what it means for a structure to be K-critical, where K is a positive integer. So a structure is K-critical if the universe has K elements and every relation has every K tuple. So it's saturated. Okay. So concretely, if I have a structure with a binary relation, this is too critical if and only if the cardinality of the universe is 2 and the relation has all possible pairs, AA, AB, BA, BB. If it was ternary, I would have to have, and it would be too critical, I would have to have AAA, BBB, AAB, et cetera. Okay, so that's the notion of what it means for a structure to be critical, trivial in some sense. A class of structures is critical if C contains a K critical structure for every K. So it contains a 1 critical, a 2 critical, and 3 critical, etc. And now it is an obvious proposition that if you have a class of structures, if the class happens to be definable by a finite set of Tgds, then C is critical. Just you look at the definition of Tgds, you look at the definition of criticality, the Tgd tells you if something happens, then some other tuples exist, but basically you have all the tuples around, so it's trivially critical. So criticality, I hope, is clear. Let's go to the next notion. This is something that comes up, of course, in the study of Horn formulas and the direct products, but here is also important, plays an important role. We need the notion of a direct product of two structures, which is a generalization of the notion of the product of two graphs. So we have two structures, always over the same schema. Then the direct product is the structure whose universe is the Cartesian product of the universes. And the relations are the products of the relations in the following sense. A relation Ri consists of all pairs A1, B1, An, Bn, so that when you take the first coordinates of these pairs, you end up in the first structure. And when you take the second coordinates of all pairs, you form a tuple belonging in the corresponding relation in the second structure. As I said, this generalizes the notion of the product of two graphs. Now you say that a class of structures is closed under direct products if whenever you have two structures in the class, then the direct product is also in the class. So closure under direct product is that the class is rich enough to contain all direct products of its members. And by induction, you can have any finite number of such products. Once you have this definition, it is not hard to prove that if you have a class of structures definable by a finite set of Tgds, then C is closed under direct products. What should I say about this proof? Not very much. Once I attended the talk by the great logician, computer scientist, Dana Scott, and he put a theorem down and he said, well, this is a self-proving theorem. And I love the term because it meant that you really look at the theorem, you use the definitions and you get the proof. I would say that this is a self-proving proposition, okay? You write the definition down and the proof falls off. Okay. So we have seen now the notions of criticality and the notion of direct product. And as I said, these are not new notions. They have been around for decades. Now we come to the notion of locality. This notion is quite technical, and I will try to explain it to you in three different levels. First, I will give you an informal description. Then we will formalize the informal description, and then I'll show you a picture. And hopefully, from the three, you'll get at least some sense. So a class of structures is local if it contains every structure which is locally embeddable in C. So you see, all these conditions express some closure property, some richness of the structure. This says that a class of structures is local if it contains every structure which is locally embeddable. Now I have to explain, of course, what do I mean by locally embeddable in quotes. Now we need a definition of what it means a structure A to be locally embeddable in a class of structures C. Intuitively, this says that for every small substructure of B of A, you can find the structure in C so that all the local neighbors of B in C can be embedded back in A while keeping the structure of B intact. As you see, there are a lot of quotes here: small, local neighbor, embedded, preserving. Embedded will be homomorphisms. Preserving will be the homomorphism is the identity of the elements of B. So I really need to explain what small and local neighbor is. The formal definition, which comes in the next slide, will be given using non-negative integers n and m as parameters to make precise the notions of small and local. I realize the next definition is technical, so if you don't absorb it, it's fine. Just keep this intuition that for every small structure inside B, I can find the structure C in C so that all the local neighbors of B in C can be mapped back to A while keeping the structure of B intact. All right, here is the formal definition. Well, okay, I need to give the definition of neighborhood. So if I have two structures, so that one is a substructure of the other, and an integer M, then the M neighborhood of B and C, the neighbors of B and C, are all the substructures of C, which contain B as a substructure and are not too big, meaning that the universe of B has cardinality, the universe of B plus M. Now we can say that if I have a class of structures and two non-negative integers, we say that A is NM locally embeddable if for every small substructure of B, that's having cardinality less than or equal than N, there is a structure C in C that contains it, and every structure in the local neighborhood, there is a homomorphism back to A, which is the identity on B. So this is the formal definition of NM locally embeddable. And then you say a class is NM local if it contains every structure which is NM locally embeddable. So you give the definition of locality with two parameters. And finally, you say a class of structure is local if it is NM local for some N and M. Okay, I appreciate the difficulty in absorbing the definition. It involves several alternations of quantifiers, but let me show you a picture for this local embeddability. Here is the picture for local embeddability. We want to define what it means for A to be locally embeddable in some class of structures calligraphic C. It means that for every small substructure of A, where small is less than or equal than N, that's the parameter, I can find some structure C which belongs to C. This structure C contains B. And if I look at the neighborhood of B in the big structure C, which belongs to the class C, and I pick there some D, that's the D, it's a neighbor of B in C, then I can map it back to A via homomorphism, which preserves B, meaning is the identity of B. And NM local, this is the definition of NM embeddability. NM local means every structure which is NM embeddable is contained in C. And the class of structures is local if it is NM local for some N and some M. Okay, so we have these three definitions of criticality, closure under products, direct products, and locality. And here again is the definition of what it means to be local. What can we say about this locality? Well, we can prove proposition three that if C is definable by a finite set of Tgds, then it is local. Okay, this is not self-proving. It is merely self-proving, because to make it self-proving, you need to realize, you have to show it is nm local for some n and m. So what is this n and what is this m? And the answer is n is the maximum number of universal quantifiers in the Tgds defining C. M is the maximum number of existential quantifiers in the Tgds defining C. So C is definable by a finite set of Tgds. You look at the maximum number of universal quantifiers occurring in the Tgds. You look at the maximum number of existential quantifiers. This gives you the parameters N and M. Once you have these parameters, it becomes a self-proving theorem to show using the definitions that C is local. So we have seen these properties. And now I can state again the theorem that says that a class is definable by a finite set of Tgds if and only if it is critical, closed under direct products, and local. Of course, it's an if and only if. We have to go both directions. Well, I just proved for you the first direction. Propositions 1, 2, and 3 were showing that if C is definable by a finite set of Tgds, it's critical. Proposition one is closed under direct products, is local. It was proposition three. So going from syntax to semantics are these three propositions. Going from semantics to syntax requires more work. I'm not going to give you all the details. I'm just going to describe the architecture of the proof. The proof is carried out in three steps. So now we start with a class of structures that has these three closed properties. We have no idea how it's definable. We have to get it to be definable by a finite set of Tgds. Using one criticality and locality, you can show with some work that C is definable by a finite set, not of Tgds, but an extension of Tgds that have disjunctions in the head, and also the atoms may contain equalities. So one criticality and locality allows you to do this. Then you use direct products, closer under direct products, to get rid of the disjunctions. And once you get rid of the disjunctions, it means that C is definable by a finite set of Tgds and equality-generating dependencies. Equality-generating dependencies, the left-hand side is a conjunction of atoms, the right-hand side has an equality. And then using criticality, the fact that this k critical for every k, you get rid of the equality generating dependencies and you get the definability by finite set of Tgd. So it is a three-step process. That's all I want to say about the proof. You can see the use of the properties is quite modular. Let me quickly describe some of the consequences. One immediate consequence is you get the characterization of full Tgds. In full Tgds, we don't have existential quantifiers. So full Tgds are n0 local for some n. And in fact, full Tgds definability by a finite set of full Tgds is characterized by criticality, closure under direct products, and n0 local for some n. A variation of this result was established by Makovsky and Vardy, who had studied this problem for full Tgds, but they did not have it for arbitrary Tgds. Going to the guarded family, remember we had linear guarded and frontier guarded. These families can be characterized, definability in these families can be characterized by adjusting appropriately the notion of locality. Locality turns out to be a very flexible notion. You can adjust it appropriately and get the results. I won't give you the definitions. These are three theorems packed as one theorem. And it says C is defined by a finite set, let's say, of guarded Tgds, if and only if it is critical, closed under direct products, and guarded local. You have to modify the notion of locality to talk about guards. And similarly, it's defined up by a finite set of linear, if and only if it's critical, closed under direct products, and linear local. So it is a flexible notion, the notion of locality we came up with, that by suitable adaptations allows you to characterize all these other families of Tgds that are part of this bigger guarded family. So we have a fairly complete picture for arbitrary sets of Tgds, full Tgds, and the members of the guarded family. And now this raises the question, what happened to the other family, the source to target Tgds? I mentioned that this result was something that Baldert and Kat and I had obtained in 2010. It's not a new result, but I'd like to go briefly over this discussion to bring data exchange to the picture, but also show you very different properties that come into the picture to characterize source to target Tgds. So let me jump to data exchange for the remaining 15 minutes of the talk or so. In data exchange, the problem is we have two schemas, and the goal is to take data structured under the first schema and transform it into data structured under the second. But we also want, of course, some constraints to be satisfied that describe the relationship between source and target. The study of data exchange for the last almost 20 years has been formalized using the notion of schema mappings. A schema mapping can be described as a semantic object or as a syntactic object. As a semantic object, a schema mapping is a triple where S is a source schema, T is a target schema, nothing in common. And W is a set of pairs of finite structures. So here, from now on, I assume that all our structures are finite, meaning the universe is finite. And such pairs, if I have such a pair AB, B is called the solution for A. In other words, if I have such a pair, it means B is a legal way to transform A into a structure under the target schema T. And that's why it's called a solution. So as I said, with this definition, a schema mapping is essentially a class of structures, but actually a class of pairs of structures. But I can think of them syntactically. Syntactically, a TGD is a triple consisting of a source schema, a target schema, and a finite set of constraints, and basically these constraints tell us how the source and schema, source and target are related, and then we want that a pair of structures satisfy sigma if and only if this pair belongs to this class W that contains all pairs so that B is a solution for A. Now, when you think of them as a syntactic object, the question that arises is, what is a good schema mapping language? And ideally, a good schema mapping language should satisfy certain desiderata, should strike a good balance between the ability to specify interesting data transformation tasks and good algorithmic behavior. So there is a certain tension here to find the sweet spot. Let me remind you now that the source to target TGD is a TGD in which the left-hand side has atoms only from the source and the right-hand side has atoms only from the target. And they have turned out to be the main specification language in data exchange. I'm not saying it's the only, but basically all the specification languages build on top of these source-to-target TGDs. And as I mentioned earlier, they are known as global and local as view or GLAV constraints. Let me argue quickly that they express interesting data transformation tasks. All of these, copying a relation, projecting some columns out of a relation, adding a column to a relation, breaking up a relation into two relations, joining two relations, or combinations of the above, they are all specified by source to target TGDs. Notice that we have come a long way, right? TGD started as integrity constraints on databases. Now we think of them in a much more dynamic way as giving us specifications for data transformation. So the use of the TGDs has evolved now. I'm talking here about source to target TGDs. And now we come to the definition of a glove mapping. Basically, a glove mapping is a schema mapping where sigma is a finite set of glove constraints, i.e. a finite set of source to target TGDs. So the question that one has to address is, what can you say about the properties of glove mappings? What properties do they possess? And can we characterize them in some structural way, the way we characterized before the other members of the various families of TGDs? Let me bring into the picture here two algorithmic problems. So there are two important algorithmic problems. One is called the existence of solutions, problems associated with a fixed schema mapping. You are given a fixed schema mapping. The first is to determine whether or not a solution for A exists. And usually you see there are many solutions. We have some underspecification, or we may have no solutions. But if many solutions exist, which solutions should we choose to materialize? Are there some solutions that are better than others? So what is the notion of a good solution? The second is a query answering problem. And this brings the notion of the certain answers, which is known to this community from various different pieces of work. Here it takes the following form. You have a fixed query over the target schema. Given a source structure A, you want to compute the certain answers of Q and A. And the certain answers of Q on A are computed as follows. You evaluate the query. Remember, the query is over the target. You evaluate the query on every solution for A. And then you take the intersection. And that gives you a very strong guarantee that these answers are going to be found in the answer to the query, no matter what solution you chose to materialize. On the face of it, this is a very difficult problem because this intersection could be very large and in fact could be infinite. So how can you bypass this issue of this very big intersection? So in the paper that started Data Exchange with Ron Phokion, René Miller, and Lucian Popa, this is the journal version of the paper in 2005, we proved that glove mappings have certain desirable properties. The first is that they admit universal solutions, meaning that they possess good solutions. Specifically, for every source instance, there is a solution B star, so that for every other solution, there is a homomorphism from B star to B, that is the identity on elements from A. And moreover, you can compute such a solution in polynomial time in the size of A via the chase procedure. The result is more general. We allow other types of constraints, but certainly it holds for the glove mappings that are the focus of this discussion. So these universal solutions, in some sense, are the most general solutions. It's a notion akin to the notion of the initial model in universal algebra, and perhaps a notion akin to the notion of the most general unifier. You have homomorphisms to all other solutions. They are the most general solutions. The other property that glove mappings have, they allow for conjunctive query rewriting, which means that for every conjunctive query over the target, you can take the query and massage it and extract out of it a union, Q prime, of conjunctive queries over the source, so that the certain answers are simply the evaluation of this rewrite on A. And this is very nice because it avoids the computation of this long, if not infinite, intersection of values of queries. So these are the two desired properties of glove mappings. You can admit universal solutions and allow for query writing. Here is a picture to show the properties of universal solutions. They are solutions. All J, J1, J2, J3, and many others are legal ways to transform A to a structure under the schema T, but the universal solutions are more general because they have homomorphisms to all these other solutions. So we have universal solutions and conjunctive query rewriting. There are two other properties. One is a closure property, and the other is a locality property. The closure property says that every glove schema mapping is closed under target homomorphisms. And this means that if you have a solution B for A, and there is a homomorphism from B to B prime, which is the identity on elements of A, it should be elements of A, then B prime is a solution for A with respect to M. So we have a closure property under target homomorphisms. And finally, there is a locality property, a different locality property, which says that if you have a pair so that B is not a solution, then there is some substructure of A which is small, so that A prime and B is already not a solution. And every glove mapping is N modular from some N. So every glove mapping admits universal solutions, allows query rewriting, is closed under target homomorphism, and is N modular. And then Baldert and Kati and I, 10 years ago or so, saw that these properties characterize glove schema mappings, meaning M is logically equivalent to a glove mapping, an arbitrary schema mapping, just a set of pairs is of structures, is logically equivalent to a glove mapping if and only if it has these four properties: admits universal solutions, allows for query rewriting, conjunctive query rewriting, is closed under target homomorphisms, and is N modular. I already argued that directions one implies two. The direction two implies one is, again, going from semantics to syntax. And that requires some work, of course. And notice that these properties are rather different. Well, modularity is a locality property, but different locality property. We have different closure properties. Certainly, admits universal solutions and allows for security writing are very different from the properties we saw before. I'm nearly the end. What we have seen here, the high-level picture, is that we can characterize TGDs in terms of these properties: criticality, closure under direct products, and locality, and where locality involves this notion of local embeddability. Source-to-target TGDs are characterized by admitting universal solutions, allowing for security writing, closure under target homomorphism, and N-modular from some N. Where is this going? Of course, there are open problems. I focused here on TGDs, but there are broader class of constraints. In particular, in database theory, people have studied in different contexts, including consistent query answering, denial constraints. This is a broad class that contains quality-generating dependencies, tuple-generating dependencies, and other constraints with built-in predicates. And it would be nice to have structural characterizations of denial constraints. We have some preliminary results with Marco Console and Andreas Pieris. The problem that I would really like to solve that has so far existed has to do with the second order TGDs that Tenkai alluded in the introduction, his kind introduction. I haven't talked at all here about the problem of composing glove mappings. Basically, you try to compose glove mappings, I'll let you think what it means, and then you realize that the composition takes you outside first order logic. It is not true that the composition of two glove mappings is a glove mapping. We have to go to second order. In fact, you have to go to existential second order, but there is a very well-behaved fragment that we isolated, we being Ron Fagin, Lucian Popa, Wang Xutan, and myself. And these are called second-order TGDs. So second-order TGDs turn out to be the right language for capturing the composition of glove mappings. I would love to have a characterization along those lines of second-order TGDs. It will help us understand the landscape a lot. We don't. Finally, let me close by discussing an area that I didn't cover. There is a related problem. which is very interesting. In this talk, all I told you is how you start with an arbitrary class of structures and how you turn it to a definable one. There is a relative expressiveness, or better thought of as a rewritability problem. I have two logics, so that L is a sublogic of L prime. I'm sorry, I forgot the L prime. When is a given formula of L logically equivalent to some formula of L prime? So L prime is the smaller logic, and when is a given formula of L logically equivalent to some formula of L prime? We have seen the first of these. If I take L to be first order and L prime to be universal first order, that's the Wostarski theorem, which tells us that a first order formula is universal if and only if it's preserved under substructions. There is a beautiful theorem that connects first order logic and modal logic, and this is Van Benten's theorem from around 1970-1971, which says a first order sentence is equivalent to a modal formula if and only if it's invariant under by simulation. So L prime is the modal logic, is actually a fragment of first order logic with two variables. L is first order logic. And this tells you when a first order formula is equivalent to a formula of modal logic, and the structural characterization there is closure under by simulation. There are results in the spirit of rewritability for description logics by Lodge, Pirro, and Walter in 2011, and these recent results last year for Tgds, including members of the guarded family by Zhang, Zhang, and Jiang, that appeared in Itzkai of last year. And in the paper with Marco and Andreas, we have some results ourselves about the complexity of rewritability when it is decidable, when you go from the Tgds to the guarded and below. So I will close with this. I thank you very much for this, for your attention and for the invitation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Phokion. And then I guess I'll do the applause. You can imagine the virtual applause from everybody else. With that, I would like to take any questions from the audience. Please raise your hand or type in the chat whether you have any questions.
Yeah, actually, I have a very basic question. Actually, at one point, I mean, earlier you mentioned the Datalog plus and minus, and so are these results you talk about somehow? I mean, I really missed. Do they apply to rules with recursion or not?
Yes, I mean this is a separate issue. You can have any recursion you want here. Okay. We're looking at the models. We're looking at the class of models that satisfy the formulas, whether they're in the guarded TGDs or arbitrary TGDs. And it's a definability of the class of models. We're looking at the class of models and we're asking, what does it take to be defined in this formalism or that formalism? Yes.
Thank you.
Of course.
And then Felix Whitecamper is the question. Good.
Thank you very much. So my question was also somewhat related to recursion. Is there anything interesting one can say if the atoms inside the TGD is computed by a positive data log programs, you actually are allowed least fixed point quantifiers inside there, but obviously not outside of the TGD. Is that interesting at all?
Inside, you mean on the left-hand side or the right-hand side?
Either. I don't know. I was thinking right-hand side or left-hand side. Yeah, either.
Yes. I don't. The short answer is I can't give you a satisfactory answer right now. That's the honest answer. We do have a lot of open problems. When we go to data exchange, the glove mappings are the entry mapping, so to speak. You can think you also have constraints on the target. Mm-hmm. And if you have constraints on the target, for instance, you can have data log constraints mm-hmm. on the target. to express transitivity, for it, to express transitive closure. We don't know of structural characterizations of schema mappings that involve source to target TGDs and target TGDs. That we don't know.
That was exactly the sort of thing I was asking. Thank you very much.
That we don't know. In fact, when Andreas and I started working on this, Marco joined us later, this was the problem we're trying to solve. And we didn't solve the problem. And then we looked at the literature and said, okay, even from the 80s, there are this, even we don't know what happens for TGDs in general. So, but when you play with these families, things become quite delicate. So,
it's quite a natural, quite a beautiful problem.
Yes, a very beautiful problem. And as I said, and I would love if someone solves the problem for second order TGDs, because I would love to know what there ought to be a look. There is no guarantee that there is a structural characterization, but the evidence we have so far is that in all the cases we have looked so far, we have been able to identify the right structural properties. And let me say this also about the structural properties. People ask, what are they good for? Well, in some sense, it tells you that if you have identified these properties, that's really all you need to know about your syntax. Everything else is going to follow from these properties. Lindstrom's theorem tells you everything you're going to prove about first order logic, you're going to prove it from compactness and Skolem Lemon. Of course, it may be very difficult to find a consequence of those, but these are the tools ultimately you will use. Okay. So this is, for me, this is the point of this structural characterization. It provides tremendous methodological information as to what tools you have to use in the study of these objects.
And it might possibly help to show that certain things are not expressible by, you have a Phokion clauses sometimes.
Absolutely. All these immediately give you, I gave already the example from the real numbers not being definable in first order logic. In the compactness theorem gives you massive inexpressibility results, because you can use the compactness theorem to prove connectivity, well-foundedness, cyclicity, two-colorability, they are not expressible. So yes, all these give you tools to prove, give you also tools to prove that you can do something with guarded that you cannot do with frontier. You can do something with frontier guarded that you cannot do with guarded, and so on. So it allows you to delineate what syntax you need to express properties. Yes, absolutely.
May I ask one more question? I don't know if anyone else.
Go ahead.
So how is this in the finite?
A very good question, excellent. So the results I discussed in the second part are only about the finite. The source to target, that's what I mean, is only about the finite. This is the results in the first part, I was very purposeful, they work both in the finite and the infinite. You get the same characterization. And this comes out by analyzing the proofs. So it's the same characterization in the finite or the same, by finite, I mean when all your structures are finite, right? So yes, you get the same result. You could have when I talked about the class C, you could have a class C of finite structures, you get the same characterization. Or the class could have finite and infinite structures. This type of thing is not automatic. Let me point out that this type of thing is not automatic. Every time requires either an analysis or a proof or a new proof. For instance, let's go to Van Benthen's theorem. Van Benthen's theorem that says a formula of first order logic is equivalent to a formula in modal logic if and only if it's preserved under by simulation. The original proof used the compactness theorem. So the original proof does not immediately hold in the finite. Many years later, Eric Rosen proved that Van Benthen's theorem also holds in the finite. So you have exactly the same result, but that's a different proof. Yeah, so some results hold in the finite, some don't. The particular results about arbitrary TGDs hold both in the finite case and the infinite case.
That's very beautiful, given that. I mean, Lushtarsky fails in the finite, and that's
Tarski fails in the finite, yes, as Bill Tate realized in 1958. The preservation under homomorphism does not fail. That of course, is Rosman's celebrated theorem from 10 years ago, 15 years ago. So some things hold in the finite, some don't. And if you want a really beautiful problem, prove a Lindstrom's theorem for first order logic in the finite. We don't have a characterization of first order logic in the finite. So we don't. This is a problem that was raised back in 1992 in a paper by Yoko Vananen and myself, when we looked at generalized quantifiers of finite structures. And we have no idea because we don't have the compactness. The Skolem-Levenheim is trivial. What should be a characterization of first order logic in the finite? We don't know.
I just want to also point out that even with respect to, for example, the classic results relating data log and polynomial time, they always assume there's an order to the database, for example. There is a lot of things.
Yes. Actually, I went back and forth with Moshe after his presentation. The Papadimitriou's result that he mentioned requires not an order, requires a successor.
Right.
Because if you need the order, but if you try to get the successor from the order, you're going to use a universal quantifier, and that's going to take you outside that order.
Right.
So, but he said it was morally correct. I mean, for the purpose of the talk, was perfect. I mean,
yes.
Yeah.
I guess I don't see any other questions. I have two questions.
Please.
Sort of more abstract in some sense. So since we're at ICLP rather than at pods, I wanted to pose you a question whether how can we bring these TGDs to the masses, so to speak, to the ICLP community in some sense? Of course, there is Datalog, for example, where we can use the programming language and so on. But in general, more variants of these TGDs.
Yes.
I guess the more general question is, how do we make pods more accessible to the ICLP community by encouraging the pods community to come up with practical examples of what can be done with these and what kind of computational complexity improvements can be had over existing methods to solving existing kind of problems? For example, with respect to Datalog, a lot of things became more popular after various program analysis, static program analysis problems were observed and so on. And then my second question is, what can be done, do you think, in terms of, you mentioned already in your, I mean, with respect to your impressive results, you're building on these tools from the 30s, 40s, 50s, etc. And whenever I work on something with database theory, logic and computer science and so on, I realized there was some work done in some ancient time that people missed, but then people perhaps are dismotivated because they think they will, their paper, especially people under paper pressure, sort of younger scientists, so to speak, are discouraged because if they publish anything related to that, they'll say, okay, this is not novel. Somebody did this in the 40s. Why are you doing that? But then the community, the computer science community, doesn't know, in particular, more practical communities, perhaps ICLP, et cetera, even SIGMOD communities, et cetera. They don't know about the results because nobody has related that into what sort of more modern computer science.
Okay, so let me attempt to answer your questions. I'm not planning to answer. First of all, yes, TGDs. If you invite Georg Godlob to give a talk to ICLP, maybe he's been invited already. I don't know. He will tell you Datalog plus minus from him is a programming language. He uses it as a programming language. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so he can make an eloquent case for that as a programming language. And it's very natural. It's just an extension of Datalog. What does he mean by a programming language? Basically, it's a language for query answering. And what are the query answers? You have a finite set of guarded TGDs, let's say, okay? And you are given a database. You look at all the database that contain the database and satisfy the axiom. And then you take the certain answers over that class. That's for him. This is what query answering. This is the ontology-mediated query answering. Okay. So he thinks of it as a programming language, and I think it should be thought that way. Now I don't know exactly the connections. That's not something I have worked on, and my interest was at a higher level, trying to understand the structure of properties of these languages. So, but yes, there is definitely a connection. In fact, in pods, we cast our paper more as a paper on with Marco and Andres. We cast our paper as a paper about ontologies because you can take the same you can think of it as ontologies, and Marco presented also last week in the description logic conference, because it is of interest to that community. The second question, if I understood correctly, you are asking, what is the value of rediscovering old results, and
how do we actually encourage perhaps rediscovering the results?
Well, I think in the panel a couple of days ago, Moshe Vardy said that there was a very important theorem by Echo and Ullman in Popple 1979 that transitive closure is not expressible in SQL, and that motivated the development of Datalog. In 1979, Echo and Ullman published a beautiful paper in Popple in which they proved that transitive closure is not expressible in first order logic. Guess what? Roland Frezé knew that in 1953. Okay, exactly, it follows from the Ehrenfreud-Frese games. That so this goes back 25 years, 26 years earlier. But I think there was a lot of value. You cannot blame them from not knowing it. Why should they know? It was a different community. So the rediscovery of the theorem turned out to be very influential. The result that Felix mentioned, that the preservation under subtractions fails in the finite. Yuri Gurevich presented it in the early 80s. Well, guess what? Bill Tate knew it in 1959. But it went unnoticed. But again, so sometimes results come before their time, and they get forgotten. And there is something to be rediscovered. It's an independent rediscovery. And yes, both people should get credit for that. On the other hand, for the young people, I think there is no substitute for being a scholar. Try to do as much scholarly work as you can. Trace the literature, go back and look. And there is benefit to digging into the old sources or talking to people who have a lot of white hair, or I mean, some white hair, don't have much hair. And they may have heard that decades ago, and they can say, this person looked at this. So I think we all need to be better scholars in that sense. I mean, that. But I don't have a problem with people discovering a result 20 or 30 years later if it's an honest, independent rediscovery. It can be very influential.
Thank you.
I thought you had two questions. If I can add to my earlier question.
Go ahead, Amy.
Yeah, so actually my question before, I said it was a recursion. I guess I'm sure you just have these arbitrary predicates. Of course, you can have recursion. But I guess the question is, when you have those, what's the semantics, right? Is this the first order semantics, or is this, you know, suppose for your subset, is the least fixed point semantics, or all your results applies to both?
This is first order semantics. I'm looking at definability. I have a set of sentences, and I'm looking at the class of models defined by the set of sentences. That's all.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. That's what I thought. Yeah, that was meant. Yeah. Yeah. But maybe even with the sort of least fixed point semantics, it would be work too, but I don't know.
I don't know.
Yeah. And also in general, right, I assume all these result works, I mean, since this is first order logic, it was all aggregation. Because it's not like even the semantics issues with aggregation.
Aggregation is tricky. Aggregation.
Or you need some Semarang. Uh-huh.
Okay. No, aggregation is tricky. Aggregation, especially if you go to the group by clause. Yes, first of all, you need Semarang. But if you go to group by, the group by takes you outside first order logic, right?
Okay.
Because what do you do with a group by? You look at the equivalence class of an equivalence relation, for definable equivalence relation. So you end up quantifying over these equivalence classes. And in fact, even the database theory community, I don't think we have done a very good job in accounting in a proper way for group by in giving kind of foundation. There is work by the finite model theory community on aggregation, where you have interpretations, for instance, over semi-rings.
Can I just axiomatize these you know, like addition or max and min, and somehow it would work?
I don't know. Okay. I don't want to venture yet.
David Warren has a question. Go ahead, David.
Yeah, I wanted to go back to Tunjay's question, second question, I think, and maybe refine it, or maybe, I don't know, maybe it's what he's trying to say, and I just didn't understand it, or maybe it's a little bit more, and that is the idea of you know, rediscovered things that were discovered before. What you said made great sense, but maybe one idea is there a way for a community to somehow figure out what earlier information, you know, earlier knowledge would be appropriate to bring in? So, you know, it happens just accidentally when somebody rediscovers something, or somebody, you know, figures out some old result. But is there some more structured way that a community might try to figure out what, you know, basic knowledge is would be appropriate and could be used? I mean, that's a very general question, and I'm not sure there's an answer. But anyway, that's a.
Thank you, David. Are you asking how do we codify knowledge so that we have a point of reference? This would be a community effort to. But let's think what happens. Very often, the same concept, because the concept is natural, is studied by different communities and they are unaware of each other. A case in point is the notion of bounded tree width, which has been extremely influential from an algorithmic perspective, from a graph theory perspective, and so on. And this has been looked by different communities, constraint satisfaction, graph theory, parameterized complexity. It took a while to realize that we're all talking about the same thing. I have been involved in some other work that has to do with going from local consistency to global consistency. And this is related, I was only aware of the work that was done by the pioneers of the relational data model, Phokion, Biri, Meyer, et cetera. Some of them were featured 2 days ago. Turns out that this work was done in the context of probability theory by Vorobyev in the 60s. And now we realize that there are all these fascinating connections. I think the point I'm trying to make that if the concepts are fundamental and there is some generality in the results, different communities discover them. Unfortunately, it's often hidden under different terminology, different notation, and there is the price of penetration is higher. So.
No, I agree exactly. I mean, I think some of the most, you also mentioned earlier that some ideas are sort of before their time.
Yes.
And nobody understands the implications of them until we get a little farther along. But I guess, I mean, and this idea, I mean, I've seen it happen a lot, not just in these very deep ideas, but even sort of not so deep ideas that they get rediscovered or re-looked at in a slightly different way and represented. And in some sense, that's very useful. I mean, that it gets it out into the community. You know, it gets the idea more, you know, available to people. And so they can use it and build on it. And they can understand it. You know, if it's expressed in some in a different language than the one I understand, if somebody just said it as a translation to me, it can help a lot. And I guess my question was, is there any, this is probably Pollyanna-ish, but is there anything that a community could do, could a conference do in, say, organizing sessions, or a journal could do in trying to track papers, or to somehow help that happen, help me learn things that would be useful to me that aren't in my language, that are from some other, you know, from some other place, other community, other, the problem is, I mean, we don't know what those things are. If we knew them, you know, I would look it up and I would know it. Sort of, it's an ignorance problem.
We don't know what we don't know. That's the problem. It's
exactly. Okay. I'll shut up.
I think the best thing that the community can do is be open and invite people from other communities. That's why I appreciate it very much, this invitation, because I'm not really a member of your community, but I care about logic in CS, broadly conceived. So I appreciate the opportunity. I think that's all we can do. And
I'd like to thank you. I'd like to thank you for coming, because I did learn. I got new insights into. I knew some of the stuff, but I got new angles. Well,
thank you. Thank you very much, David.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I don't see any other question, and I would like to thank Phokion again, Efaristopoli in Greek.
So thank you.
And thank you.
I guess we conclude the session here, and today, I guess we have the programming contest later, but for now, today, ICLP is finished. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye. Thank you, everyone. Bye. See you tomorrow.
Bye.
Thanks again.
Bye-bye.